So from this video onwards, we'll start looking at perturbations to metabolic networks, wherein we'll particularly start focusing on gene deletions or reaction deletions. And in this video, we'll focus also on gene-protein reaction associations, which is central to our understanding of, you know, what happens when you remove a gene or a reaction from the model, right? So there is a relationship between genes and reactions, a many-to-many relationship, in fact. So when you remove a particular set of genes, there is a particular set of reactions that go out, and so on. So if you recall, the whole premise of systems biology, or the whole a very important aspect of systems biology, is to be able to study perturbations, knock something out, add something in, see what's the effect, right? And metabolic networks can be perturbed primarily by removal of genes or overexpression of genes or reactions as well, right? And the effect of such changes can be studied using constraint based techniques such as FBA, MoMA, Room. So Room was the name of the third other method, right? It was regulatory on off minimization. So the ability to analyze alternate genotypes or strains is of great importance in metabolic engineering and drug target identification. And so this is a very commonly used technique wherein we try to see how to reroute, right? I think I did mention it a few classes earlier. This is what the cell is trying to do, and you want to reroute it towards this. So can you delete some genes, increase some genes? So for metabolic engineering, we are primarily interested in identifying genotypes that have improved properties, whereas for drug target identification, we want the opposite. You want to identify phenotypes that are lethal. What genes do I hit in the pathogenic organism so that I stop it from growing? And there are many approaches that have been taken for identifying these kinds of essential genes. So there are some basic network topology measures which look at load points and choke points and so on. There are again centrality measures that have been used, and machine learning. But the most effective, or the most, you know, more reliable methods involve flux balance analysis, because flux balance, when you have a good model, can give you very robust predictions. So let's look at gene deletions. For any of the constraint based approach, gene deletions can be simply done by altering the constraints on a set of reactions. So at this point, it's important to recall what is a GPR. We did this some classes ago. Gene protein reaction associations, right? Succinate dehydrogenase A, and a gene succinate dehydrogenase B, which codes for a protein SDHA, SDHB, and maybe they complex together to form a protein SDHAB, which catalyzes reaction 1 and reaction 2. So which means if you now remove SDHA, reaction 1 will be turned off. You remove SDHB, reaction 2 will be turned off. And in fact, there is no way to turn off reaction. So I should draw it maybe like this. There is no way to turn off reaction 1 alone, right? Because to turn off reaction 1, you will need to remove SDHA, which will automatically turn off reaction 2, right? So this can translate to a set of Boolean rules. So you can say R1 is G1 and G2, right? Or let me just use the AND symbol. Or R2 is G2 or G3 or G4, right? So these are like isozymes, and this is like an enzyme complex. Oh yeah. So isozymes are enzymes that are equivalent, right? So they may be able to substitute for one another, but they may be different. We will just come back to that. So they may not be perfectly equals,
right. So, isozyme 1 might do the reaction very well, isozyme 2 might be able to do the reaction to 80% of that capability. So, you might end up it might end up that the organism grows slower when you delete isozyme 1, but when you delete isozyme 2, there is no effect on the organism. Once again, what does it mean to delete a reaction? We said V5 equal to 0 is what we said, but how do we put that as a constraint? Easiest way to do it is set lower bound and upper bound as 0. You can add another column to the stoichiometric matrix if you want, right, where you just have V5 alone, right, and then say that that is equal to 0, but it makes it is much easier to basically add change the lower bound and upper bound vectors. So, typically you change the lower and upper bounds to 0. Following this change in constraints, you can re-simulate the system using any algorithm of your choice, FBA, MoMA, Room, whatever, corresponding to the altered genotype, the perturbed genotype. But you should still watch out for the growth of the new strain, especially in case of metabolic engineering. The growth rate really drops, even though you get enough product, it may not be sufficient, right. So, you can either delete reactions or genes from a model, right. So, what is the difference between the two?
Genes, the enzyme goes
off here, you are just directly. So, it will finally have to result in a reaction deletion, right. But then when you delete reactions alone, you may be doing some unacceptable deletions. As I showed in the previous example, you could not have deleted R1 alone, right. There was no way to delete R1 alone because so, if you wanted to delete R1, you have to remove one of these, which means R2 will go out automatically. So, this simulation is not biologically relevant in some sense, but it is just a unit of the reaction still remains a unit of the model, right. The unit in the model where which you can delete still remains a reaction. There is no meaning in removing a gene from the reaction, from the model. When you say you remove a gene from a model, it means that you are removing all the corresponding reactions out of the model. But in terms of the wet lab, the genes are the unit of deletion. You cannot knock out a reaction in the wet lab. You will be able to knock out a gene using siRNA or any of those techniques, right. So, it is also possible to delete reactions, but you have to be careful because of these complex gene protein reaction relationships. So, this relationship between genes, proteins and reactions is often not one to one. So, it can be even more complex. So, we just had a simple example here. You already see this is one to many, right. So, you can have another R3 which is G1 or G2. So, when you touch G1 or when you touch G2 here, all these reactions are going to change. In fact, only this, but you will have to see what is the effect on all the reactions where G2 is involved. It could be something like, so you can have very complex gene protein reaction associations. So, a metabolic reaction can be carried out by one or more enzymes. It could be a multi-enzyme complex that is carrying out a complex series of reactions. So, the same enzyme carries out 20 reactions, it is quite possible, right. It could be a polymerase like or a fatty acid synthase. And an enzyme can catalyze multiple reactions that utilize different substrates, promiscuous enzymes. Different enzymes may catalyze the same reaction, your isozymes. So, consequently, the removal of a reaction may require deletion of multiple genes and may accompany the removal of additional reactions as well, right, which can result in a very different metabolic solution space from what you do when you just remove one reaction at a time. So, when you remove G2 here, it takes away R1 and R3, right. So, it has effect on several reactions at the same time. So, then again, due to the presence of isozymes, a strategy corresponding to minimum number of reaction deletions does not correspond to a strategy with the minimum number of gene deletions, simply because there are 4 genes in E. coli that can function as serine deaminases. So, to completely remove that reaction, that reaction is something like R4 is G5 or G6 or G7 or G8. So, to remove R4, you have to knock out all these 4. This might be quite a challenge experimentally to knock out 4 enzymes. So, there are some very nice tools that are useful for these kinds of studies. So, there is OptFlux, which is a very user friendly computational tool for metabolic engineering. It is an open source and modular software for strain optimization. It also uses simulated annealing and evolutionary algorithms to optimize the genotype. It basically tries to do a search in genotype space. The optimization is essentially on the genotype. Can I find the best genotype that has the optimal genotype that has my interesting phenotype? And it can use FBA, MoMA, Room, and there are other two. We will study about elementary fluxes later on, and it seems to be the benchmark for metabolic engineering. And these are two very good papers which I think you should take a look at. RobustKnock is another tool, and the first methods in molecular biology chapter essentially talks a lot about the protocol for doing gene deletion. You set this to 0, then you observe this, what does it mean, when will you get a true positive, true negative. We will try to discuss some of these in the coming class.
So, in this video we had an overview of how we perform gene deletions or reaction deletions, how do we set up that as an optimization problem, and we also understood that, you know, there is a correspondence between genes and reactions which is usually captured via the gene protein reaction associations, and this is important to know what genes can be deleted or what genes need to be deleted when you want to turn off a reaction and vice versa. In the next video we will do a lab wherein we look at this all important function, or you know, I could call it even the FBA function called optimized CB model. It performs both FBA and I think even MoMA, and we will also understand the concept of exchange reactions and how do you find them out from a model, because if you want to change the medium of growth for a model and so on, how do we go about doing it. And we will also do a simple experiment wherein we vary glucose uptake rates and study what is the effect on growth rate of the organism.